Hachette Audio presents How the Word is Passed, a reckoning with the history of slavery across America. Written and read by Clint Smith. Our past was slavery. We cannot recur to it with any sense of complacency or composure. The history of it is a record of stripes, a revelation of agony. It is written in characters of blood. Its breath is a sigh, its voice a groan, and we turn from it with a shudder. The duty of today is to meet the questions that confront us with intelligence and courage. Frederick Douglass, The Nation's Problem. You know, they straightened out the Mississippi River in places to make room for houses and livable acreage. Occasionally, the river floods these places. Floods is the word they use. But in fact, it is not flooding. It is remembering. Remembering where it used to be. Toni Morrison, The Site of Memory. Author's note. The visits I describe in this book took place between October 2017 and February 2020. I visited some places on multiple occasions, others only once. All quotations were captured with a digital recorder. Some names have been changed to protect the privacy of individuals. I would like to note that while this book is focused on the places where the story of slavery in America lives on, the land upon which many of these historical sites sit belonged to indigenous communities before it belonged to anyone else. Of the 8 U.S.-based sites I visited for this book, New Orleans sits on Chitimacha and Choctaw land, Monticello sits on Monacan land, the Whitney Plantation sits on Choctaw land, Angola Prison sits on Choctaw land, the Blandford Cemetery sits on Appomattox and Nottoway land, Galveston, Texas sits on Akokisa, Karankawa, Atakapa land, New York City sits on Munsee Lenape land. The National Museum of African American History and Culture sits on Nacatank or Anacostan and Piscataway land. It should be noted that Native territories often overlapped and had malleable borders that shifted over time. This list is not definitive, but is one attempt to acknowledge those who first traversed this land and to do so as accurately as possible. Prologue. The whole city is a memorial to slavery. The sky above the Mississippi River stretched out like a song. The river was still in the windless afternoon, its water a yellowish brown from the sediment it carried across thousands of miles of farmland, cities, and suburbs on its way south. At dusk, the lights of the Crescent City Connection, a pair of steel cantilever bridges that cross the river and connect the east and west banks of New Orleans, flickered on. Luminous bulbs ornamented the bridge's steel beams, like a congregation of fireflies settling onto the backs of two massive, unbothered creatures. A tugboat made its way downriver, pulling an enormous ship in its wake. The sounds of the French Quarter, just behind me, pulsed through the brick sidewalk underfoot. A pop-up brass band blared into the early evening air, its trumpets, tubas, and trombones commingling with the delight of a gathering crowd. A young man drummed on a pair of upturned plastic buckets, the drumsticks in his hands moving with speed and dexterity. People gathered for photos along the river's edge, hoping to capture an image of themselves surrounded by a recognizable piece of quintessential New Orleans iconography. After the transatlantic slave trade was outlawed in 1808, about 1 million people were transported from the Upper South to the Lower South. More than 100,000 of them were brought down the Mississippi River and sold in New Orleans. Leon A. Waters came and stood next to me on the riverfront, hands in pockets, lips compressed, overlooking the Mississippi's slow bend between the two shores of the city. I had been introduced to Waters by a group of young black activists in New Orleans who were part of the organization Take 'em Down NOLA, whose self-espoused mission is the removal of all symbols of white supremacy in New Orleans as part of a broader push for racial and economic justice. Waters has served as a mentor to many members of the group. They see him as an elder statesman of their movement and credit him for being a central part of their political education. Waters, in his late 60s, with a graying mustache sitting over his lips, wore a black sports coat with a gray and white striped shirt with the top button undone. A navy blue tie hung loosely below his unfastened collar and swung over the waistband of his faded blue jeans. A pair of thin-frame, rectangular-shaped glasses sat high on the bridge of his nose, the left lens with a slight smudge in its bottom corner. His voice was low and unvarying in its tone. Waters might be mistaken for surly, but his disposition is simply a reflection of the seriousness with which he takes the subject matter he is often discussing, the subject of slavery. We were standing in front of a plaque recently put up by the New Orleans Committee to erect markers on the slave trade, outlining Louisiana's relationship to the transatlantic slave trade. "It's doing its job," Waters said of the plaque. "All through the day, people come in, they stop, they read, take pictures. It's another way of educating people to this." In recent years, markers like this began to go up throughout the city, each documenting a specific area's relationship to enslavement, part of a broader reckoning. After years of black people being killed by police and having their deaths broadcast in videos streamed across the world, after a white supremacist went into a black church in Charleston, South Carolina, and killed 9 people as they prayed, after neo-Nazis marched in Charlottesville, Virginia, to protect a Confederate statue and reclaim a history born of a lie, after George Floyd was killed by a police officer's knee on his neck, cities across the country have begun to more fully reckon with the history that made such moments possible. A history that many had previously been unwilling to acknowledge. Waters, who identifies as a local historian and revolutionary, was not new to this. He and others like him have for years been working to illuminate the city's legacy, and by extension the country's legacy, of oppression. Only recently, after decades of pushing by activists amid the larger groundswell of national pressure, have city officials begun to listen, or perhaps feel like they finally have the political capital to act. In 2017, New Orleans removed 4 statues and monuments that, it had determined, paid tribute to the legacy of white supremacy. The city removed memorials to Robert E. Lee, the general who led the Confederacy's most successful army during the Civil War, a slaveholder. Jefferson Davis, the first and only president of the Confederacy, a slaveholder. P.G.T. Beauregard, a general in the Confederate Army who ordered the first shots of the Civil War, a slaveholder. And a monument dedicated to the Battle of Liberty Place, an 1874 insurrection in which white supremacists attempted to overthrow the integrated Reconstruction-era state government of Louisiana. These monuments are gone now, but at least 100 streets, statues, parks, and schools named after Confederate figures, slaveholders, and defenders of slavery remain. On a cool February afternoon, Waters, the founder of Hidden History Tours of New Orleans, promised to show me where some of these vestiges of the past remain. Waters drove me past 2 schools named after John McDonough, a wealthy slave-owning merchant after whom dozens of schools, filled largely with black children, were named until the 1990s. We drove past shops and restaurants and hotels where there had once been offices, showrooms, and slave pens of more than a dozen slave trading firms that made New Orleans the largest slave market in antebellum America. Like the Omni Royal Orleans Hotel, built on the site of the St. Louis Hotel, where men, women, and children were bought, sold, and separated from one another. We drove past Jackson Square, in the heart of the tourist-filled French Quarter, where rebellious enslaved people were executed. Even the street on which Waters dropped me off at the end of our tour, where my parents live now, is named after Bernard de Marigny, a man who owned more than 150 enslaved people over the course of his lifetime. The echo of enslavement is everywhere. It is in the levees, originally built by enslaved labor. It is in the detailed architecture of some of the city's oldest buildings, sculpted by enslaved hands. It is in the roads, first paved by enslaved people. As historian Walter Johnson has said about New Orleans, the whole city is a memorial to slavery. New Orleans is my home. It is where I was born and raised. It is a part of me in ways I continue to discover. But I came to realize that I knew relatively little about my hometown's relationship to the centuries of bondage rooted in the city's soft earth, in the statues I had walked past daily, the names of streets I had lived on, the schools I had attended, and the buildings that had once been nothing more to me than the remnants of colonial architecture. It was all right in front of me, even when I didn't know to look for it. It was in May 2017, after the statue of Robert E. Lee near downtown New Orleans had been taken down from its 60-foot pedestal, that I became obsessed with how slavery is remembered and reckoned with teaching myself all the things I wish someone had taught me long ago. Our country is in a moment, at an inflection point, in which there is a willingness to more fully grapple with the legacy of slavery and how it shaped the world we live in today. But it seems that the more purposefully some places attempt to tell the truth about their proximity to slavery and its aftermath, the more staunchly other places have refused. I wanted to visit some of these places, those telling the truth, those running from it, and those doing something in between, in order to understand this reckoning. In How the Word is Passed, I traveled to 8 places in the United States, as well as 1 abroad, to understand how each reckons with its relationship to the history of American slavery. I visit a mix of plantations, prisons, cemeteries, museums, memorials, houses, historical landmarks, and cities. The majority of these sites are in the South, as this is where slavery was most saturated over the course of its nearly 250-year existence on these shores. But I also travel to New York City and Dakar, Senegal. Each chapter is a portrait of a place, but also of the people in that place, those who live there, work there, and are the descendants of the land and of the families who once lived on it. There are people who have tasked themselves with telling the story of that place outside traditional classrooms and beyond the pages of textbooks. They are, formally or informally, public historians who carry with them a piece of this country's collective memory. They have dedicated their lives to sharing this history with others. And for this book, many of them have generously shared that history with me. Monticello Plantation. There's a difference between history and nostalgia. Heading out from my home in Washington, D.C. in the morning, I drove against traffic, moving from the new condos of an increasingly gentrifying D.C. through the single-family home suburban landscape of Northern Virginia and into the vast green expanse surrounding I-95 South. As I drove to Monticello, I observed how Virginia is largely a tale of two states. Northern Virginia, those incorporated municipalities that serve as suburbs to the District of Columbia.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.